week. Good morning. That was better. Welcome to Philadelphia Presbyterian Church. Welcome to God's house. We are so grateful that you are worshiping with us today. It is always an honor and a privilege to have you with us. I'd like to draw your attention to our order of service. You can follow along with us in the bulletin. You can also follow along on the screens to my left and my right. And also, I'd like to draw your attention to our center aisle where you will find a black pew pad. Oh, my New England accent just came out, didn't it? You will find a black pew pad. If you would sign it and pass it down to the person next to you, we'd like to know that you've been worshiping with us this morning. In our order of service, you will find out all of the wonderful and exciting things that are happening here at Philadelphia, including the pink insert, which is for our women's retreat. Our women's retreat is on March 4th. This retreat is for our high school youth through 114 years old. And it's also not just for the women of Philadelphia. It is for your friends, your extended family, so please make sure you register. We know it is for the whole day, but for the whole day, you will have a chance if you feel like you have been overwhelmed with your schedule, if you feel like you are not enough, if you are tired, if you feel like you are no longer lovely, come find your lovely that Saturday. We will have art and worship and prayer and music, so come join us. The event is free, and again, invite your friends to join you. And now it is very rare that we have the opportunity to have someone who turns 90 years old and worshiping with us on a Sunday morning. But Evan Udy is 90 years old today. Happy birthday. I think maybe if you're 90 years old and you're in church on Sunday morning, we should sing happy birthday. What do you think? Yeah. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. I will make sure that we speak out the Lord's Prayer today. Because I remember what you threatened the last time, and I can't tell the whole congregation. And now, my friends, it is that time where we have the honor and the privilege to pass the peace and love of Jesus Christ to our friends and neighbors. The peace of Christ be with you. The peace of Christ be with you. My friends, let us continue to worship the Lord.
Jane was still talking. Jane was still talking.
Up and was reading my scripture reading this morning, I was struck by the passage that I was led to. I am always humbled to have the opportunity to pray in worship service, and I always feel a bit overwhelmed that I am the one given the honor and the privilege to lead the prayer. But when we have corporate prayer, I have to be mindful that it is my voice, but we are all praying together. And that is a powerful thing when I get to look out and see all of our faces. It's not just me, but it is all of us praying together. We get up and we greet each other and we pass the peace. And for many of us, that's the most exciting time. But for me, it's the opportunity to be able to pray together that is the most fulfilling moment for me in worship service. And so the scripture that I read this morning, I want to share with you before we pray. It comes from James 5, 13 through 15. And it says from the Message, are you hurting? Pray. Do you feel great? Sing. Are you sick? Call the church leaders together and pray and anoint you with oil in the name of the Master. Believing, prayer will heal you and Jesus will put you on your feet. And if you've sinned, you'll be forgiven, healed inside and out. My friends, I will first start with a moment of silence so we can meditate. We can confess our sins. We can speak to the Lord silently about what has been pressing on our hearts. And then I will pray. And then we will lift our voices loudly and say the Lord's Prayer together in one voice. My friends, let us pray. Creator God, we are your children, and we come to you right now standing in the need of prayer. So often we let our lives and the busyness of them distract us from you and what it is you call us to do. Our schedules get hectic. People frustrate us. Life can be daunting. And so we ask right now that you revive our commitment to you, that we are able to walk the journey with you and not with all this stuff on the outside that keeps us distracted from staying in your word and praying together and lifting each other up. Because sometimes we get frustrated, God, and we say no one's here for us, but we need to look in the mirror and remember that sometimes we are not here for each other. Lord, we have been given so very much. You create each tiny blade of grass. You provide for us in abundance, so much so that we need to remember to open our hands and share with others. God, we are so grateful for this church family, for our community, and for the world. There is so much that goes through our ears and through all of the social media outlets and the news that can leave us confused and overwhelmed and divided, Lord. But in you, we are united. We are one children, and we need to be mindful that the foot of the cross was level. In you, you treat each one of us the same. There are no favorites. There is no sin that is worse than the other. And for that, we are so grateful. Grateful for forgiveness. Thankful for a second chance. Humbled by all that Jesus did for us. Lord, we ask that you go by the hospitals and the nursing homes. Work through the hands of the nurses and the doctors and the caregivers. Give them extraordinary energy and patience and healing power. Where there is cancer, remove it. Where there is addiction, take the taste out of mouths. Go into our homes where there are broken marriages, heal them in a way that only you can. Revive prayer, hope, conversations, and healing. For those of us who stumble and can't seem to find a way to communicate or work together, God, mend fences, mediate conversations. Lord, we are so, so blessed and so grateful. We thank you for your son, Jesus, who gave it all for us, the one who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. My friends, when you are hungry, the Lord will feed you. When you are broken, the Lord will heal you. When you have sinned, the Lord will forgive you. Trust and believe, no matter what the situation, no matter how desperate you may feel, God is always with you. In Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Anybody gonna ask me why? Oh, I smell so bad. Do I smell bad? I do. Oh my goodness, it's been terrible. I've been inside of a fish for 3 days. A fish. I smell like the belly of a fish. Do you think I'm happy? Do you think I'm sad? Do you think I smell like fish? No. I smell like sardines. Oh, I'm so unhappy. Do you know what happened? God wanted me to do something. Do anybody know my name? Jonah. God wanted me to do something nice. God wanted me to help people. Do you know what I told God? I told him, no, because I'm going to do what I want to do. And do you know what God did? God helped me figure out that I need to listen to what God says. Do you think being in the belly of a fish would help you figure out that what God wants is important? If God said, you know what, I want you to go help people, and you said, no. I was inside a whale. Don't I smell like it? But do you know what? Oh, feeling a little better. Wait a minute. You know, actually, after 3 days of being inside that whale, do you know what? I thought about what God said. You have a lot of time to think inside of the belly of a whale. Thought about what God said, and I was like, you know, all God wanted me to do was help people. God always wants to help people. And I said, wait a minute, I didn't want to help people because I was thinking about who? So I went the other way. God said, I think I'm going to give you a gentle reminder that it's important to help other people, not just think of yourself. Gentle reminder. Exactly. God helps us. Broccoli can be a gentle rabbi. Do you know, God wants us to do good things for ourselves and for others. And sometimes we don't listen. But God helps us. Now, does anybody want to get swallowed by a whale? Probably not a great idea. But do we want to do things for people that we should? Should we try to help? Okay, do we always do that? Sometimes we think about ourselves. I don't feel like it, God. I don't want to do it, God. I don't like them, God. But God sometimes helps us understand that even though we don't feel like it or want to do it, we should. And sometimes when we don't feel like it, somebody reminds us by doing a kind and loving thing for us. Do you know God actually helped me out? Yes, he made a fish swallow me. But he also got me out of there. He got me out of there while I was still kicking. He got me out of there and said, you know what? People need your help. I think you should go help them. What do you think? And after 3 days in the belly of a fish, I thought it was a pretty good idea. So do you know what? I want you to listen for the voices of people around you and all the things that show God's love, and let them remind you that even when we don't feel like it, or even when maybe we don't think we can do it, God calls us to help. So we can find ways, no matter who we are, where we are, what we're doing, to see and hear God and help. Because when we do, those people, just like Jonah, will appreciate God's help and your help because God is working through you to help them. And they might even feel like their life was so terrible and you helped them out that it was just like being free from the belly of a whale. Imagine that. Can you put your hands together? Close our eyes and say, Dear God, thank you for helping us. Help us always to be helpful to others just like you want, and no matter how we feel. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all so very much, as always, for leading us in song and worship. Anybody here a fan of Scripture? Today is your day. Today is your day. Our first Scripture reading comes from the book of Jonah. So settle in. Because you can't do this without doing it this way. I invite you to hear God's word. The word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai. Go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it, because its wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. He went down to Joppa, where he found a ship bound for that port. And after paying the fare, he went aboard and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. Then the Lord sent a great wind on the sea, and such a violent storm arose that the ship threatened to break up. All the sailors were afraid, and each cried out to his own God, and they threw the cargo into the sea to lighten the ship. But Jonah had gone below deck, where he lay down and fell into a deep sleep. The captain went to him and said, "How can you sleep? Get up and call on your God. Maybe he will take notice of us so we will not perish." Then the sailors said to each other, "Come, let us cast lots to find out who is responsible for this calamity." They cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. So they asked him, "Tell us, who is responsible for making all this trouble for us? What kind of work do you do? Where do you come from? What is your country? From what people are you?" I.e., they freaked out. He answered, "I am a Hebrew, and I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land." This terrified them, and they asked, "What have you done?" They knew he was running away from the Lord because he had already told them so. The sea was getting rougher and rougher. So they asked him, "What should we do to you to make the sea calm down for us?" Would that be a daunting statement to you? "Pick me up and throw me into the sea," he replied, "and then it will become calm. I know it is my fault that this great storm has come upon you." Instead, the men did their best to row back to land, but they could not, for the sea grew even wilder than before. They cried out to the Lord, "Please, do not let us die for taking this man's life. Do not hold us accountable for killing an innocent man. For you, Lord, have done as you pleased." Then they took Jonah and threw him overboard, and the raging sea grew calm. At this, the men greatly feared the Lord, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows to him. And now the Lord provided a huge fish to swallow Jonah. I love "provided a huge fish to swallow Jonah." And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. From inside the fish, Jonah prayed to the Lord his God. Wouldn't you? He said, "In my distress, I called to the Lord, and he answered me. From deep in the realm of the dead, I called for help, and you listened to my cry. You hurled me into the depths, into the very heart of the seas, and the current swirled about me. All your waves and breakers swept over me. I said, 'I have been banished from your sight, and yet I will look again towards your holy temple.' The engulfing waters threatened me. The deep surrounded me. Seaweed was wrapped around my head. To the roots of the mountains I sank down. The earth beneath barred me in forever. But you, Lord my God, brought my life up from the pit. When my life was ebbing away, I remembered you, Lord, and my prayer rose to you, to your holy temple. Those who cling to worthless idols turn away from God's love for them, but I, with shouts of grateful praise, will sacrifice to you. What I have vowed, I will make good. I will say, salvation comes from the Lord. And the Lord commanded the fish, and it vomited Jonah onto the dry land. Woo-hoo, said Jonah. I added that last part. That was me. from the New Testament. Basically, the summation of the story and the application in real life for everybody. The book of Galatians chapter 6. Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. Whoever sows to please their flesh, from the flesh will reap destruction. Whoever sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Have you ever heard that phrase, wherever you go, there you are? What it means is this. If we're adventure hikers on Mount Huashan, we are here. Anybody want to hike that trail? And if we are hanging with the sharks and they're trying to hang with us, we are. Jonah appropriate stuff. Adventure, danger, sharks, fish trying to eat you. One more appropriate adventure, dangerous, exciting thing. Video, please, Jonah. Oh, back up one more. The cam. The congregation. It's so exciting. Yes! The adventure of Sunday morning at PPC. Rock on! All these things are so different, but they are all this morning experiences that we get to have. And it is experience that shapes our lives. Experience makes us who we are. Our experiences are the things that we have, and when we go out and have them, whatever they are, they inform, shape our life. Let me ask you a question. Would it shape your life to be on a foot and a half wide plank on the side of a mountain like the cliff-hanging people were? Would it shape your life? If you thought it was a wonderful thing, you'd be like, this is so cool. If you were scared of heights, how would you feel? Absolutely. How would you feel like if you were in that boat with the shark biting on the side of it? If you were a shark-loving person who thinks sharks biting your boat would be cool, you'd love it. If you were me, you'd be freaking out. And what would that do to the people around you? Ah, the sharks are going to get us. Ah, ah, ah. What would that do to them? Probably make them laugh. Look at that guy. You know, the race, it's hard to do because the race car at Le Mans is actually in a 360 3D video, and it's hard to do if you don't have the glasses. But anybody feel the kick when that thing moved at like 170, 180 miles an hour? You're like, man, does worship move you? This morning, hopefully, a little bit. The story of Jonah is about three things. One, Jonah's experience. Two, the effect that experience had on Jonah. And three, the choices he made because of it. That's our life. We have experiences. Those experiences shape who we are. And then we make choices because of them. If your spouse or friends said, I really, really, really love heights. I'm going to go hike Mount Huashan. Whatever it is. 12,000 feet high on a 200-year-old plank piece of wood. He said, I really want to go. Let's go. Would you go?
No.
If you didn't go, would they be disappointed? What if it's less than that? What if it's, hey, let's go get Chinese food? I don't like Chinese food. But we go where you go, every want to go every time. Let's go somewhere else. I don't want to go there. My experience isn't such that I want to do that. But I want to do it. How do you think that situation ends up? Anybody ever had it before? Be honest. Anybody have it most every day? We don't live in a vacuum. Our experiences affect our choices. Our choices affect our life. Our life affects the lives of people around us. How did it affect Jonah? God said, go. Jonah said, no. God said, storm, big blow. Cats on the ship said, bro, you got to go. Jonah said, whoa, that's a big fish. I ended up in the belly below. In 3 days, he said, hey, God, I'm ready to go. God said, puke him out, yo. Whale said, show. Jonah preached. Nineveh showed sin the dough. And they were saved, saved, saved. Okay. Our experiences are what make up our life. You ever heard that song, be careful little eyes what you see? Be careful little ears what you hear. Whatever you see, whatever I see, whatever you do, whatever I do, it affects me. It changes the way I see things. And the thing is, I don't live in a vacuum. I know it's not on a page, but I don't live in a vacuum. Watch this. You don't live in a vacuum either. Your life is not your own. Our life belongs to God. And God made us to be about certain things, not just for us, but for others. For each other. So what we do, what we say, what we believe matters. God told Jonah, go to Nineveh, because Nineveh is a wicked city. They're doing terrible things. I know it makes sense. We should kick them to the curb, but I don't go that way. I want them to be redeemed. Because they're people, I made them, I love them. I want them to be able to know the good experience of God so they can share it with others. This is how the process works, Jonah. Jonah said, I don't think so. So God says, well, I'm going to make a compelling case to you, Jonah, that my desire is worth your time. So God gave Jonah a few life experiences that helped him understand the importance of sowing God's seeds instead of Jonah's weeds. The scriptures say it like this: whoever sows to please their flesh, from the flesh will reap destruction. Can there be a better example than Jonah? Whoever sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. Jonah prays 3 days after sowing his weeds. God gives him life and says, now, brother, go sow the seed. Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people. The story of Jonah is all about God making for Jonah and for us a rather compelling case of how important it is for us to shoot for good experiences. for those experiences to define who we are. And three, for us to sow the seed instead of the weed. How do we do that? Pursue God. There are lots of options out there. Jonah tried. I am not going to listen. I'm going to do what I want to do. How did it work out? I'd say it was a little fishy. Don't quit your day job. How does it ever work out? I'm just going to do my thing. Might not be the right thing, but I'm going to do my thing. I'm going to have my attitude. I'm going to fuss when I feel like fussing. I'm going to be selfish. I'm going to be greedy. I'm going to make comments about other people that hurt them because I'm having a bad day, or I don't like them, or I'm upset. And that's just going to be how it is. How does that work? Does it help us? How does it make you feel when you act like that with someone else or yourself? How does it make you feel? Does it ever make us feel good? Or do we feel guilty? Worn out, knowing it was the wrong thing to do. But then on the other side, what if we, in those times, we're here in the belly of the fish, and we get there, y'all, we just do. It's life. We're human. But when we're there, if we say, oh, God, I have put myself in the belly of this fish, and it flat out smells bad. And I don't want to be here. Could you give a brother or sister a hand? Because in my heart, what I really want is not what I did. Paul says it in the New Testament. We do the things we don't want to do, and the things we really should do, we don't. I'm really not doing what I really know I should be doing, and I know I messed up. But you know what, God? I'm me. I'm Jonah. I don't listen. I don't do what I need to do. I don't help other people, but I really, really do want to. Can you help me out? You know what God says? That's the experience you need to pursue. The more we do, the better it goes. And it might take us a little while to not smell like vomit, but eventually we'll clean up and follow the pursuits of God, seeds over weeds. And as we do, we will gain knowledge and wisdom and experience that says, man, this is so much better. I love loving on people more than being difficult. I love pursuing the things of justice and goodness and patience, forgiveness, kindness, love, a kind word, more than I do making things difficult or hard. Makes me feel better and they feel better. You ever have that experience? Somebody's having a bad day and you're like, by heaven, you're just mean as a snake. I'm going to do everything I can, no matter how much you hate me at the end of the day, to make you feel better. You ever been that person? Try it. It's really cool. It annoys people. But if you won't go away with kindness, they have no choice but either one, to walk away, or two, succumb. And then they feel better, and you feel better, and you got this cool bond with somebody. God is pleased. What was God sowing with Jonah? Hope for Nineveh, that wicked city, to have the experience of redemption. What else was God sowing with Jonah? Hope for Jonah, that he too might have this experience of redemption so he could share it with Nineveh. Seeds over weeds. God is serious. Whether it be the loving forgiveness of Christ or the providential hand of God that will put us on the path he wants us to go, whether we like it or not. God makes a compelling case. And if we have any doubts about that, we can check out Jonah. And maybe the way he feels and smells after chasing the boat, dealing with the storm, and living in the belly of the fish, maybe we'll find in his an experience that, like Jonah, draws us closer to God. The encouragement is this: seek the experience of seeds rather than the experience of weeds. And you will find that the compelling case that God makes to us all of this kind of life is well worth the pursuit, is the very experience of life itself that brings the redemption God desires for us all. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
To that hymn were really powerful. Amen?
Amen?
If we can follow them every single day, the world would be a much different place. My friends, would you join me now in saying what it is that we believe, the Apostles' Creed? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he arose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I'd like to have Mark McClure come forward for a special announcement.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I've been asked by finance to come up and speak to you guys for a few minutes. I'm going to date myself a little bit. Who remembers Ginsu knives? The knife that can slice through steel and still slice a tomato. How about the guy Billy Mays with the OxyClean that cleans everything instantly, right? I got one more. The new stuff. Everybody seen this? Flex Seal. You can spray it on a boat and it'll seal it up and you can sail away. There's always something that sort of goes along with these. There's that end of the commercial. It's always the same thing. But wait, there's more. Act now and you get another one for free. Well, we actually have kind of this situation at our church right now. But the good news is, it's not too good to be true. We have a real opportunity. Here's what the opportunity is. You guys know that several years ago, we took out the bonds to purchase the house next door. Those bonds are coming due. We made an announcement a couple weeks ago about $180,000 plus interest in bonds that we have to pay back. And we've begun pursuing some options, namely a mortgage against that house to pay back the bonds and the interest that's owed on them. So, what does Flex Seal have to do with this house? Here's what we have in front of us. In the several weeks since we made that announcement, God has called someone who wants to remain anonymous, and they have told us if we can raise $1, they will donate $2. And they will do that up to $120,000 to help us pay off that house and avoid a mortgage. So let's do the math. Here's what this means. If we can find $60,000 to buy this, someone will give us $120,000 for this. And we take no mortgage against it. We have to find a way to pay for a third of a house. Here's the infomercial part of it. You have to act now. We have to make a decision on going forward with this mortgage. How big or small it may be, if we reach the whole goal, there is no mortgage. If we reach part of it, the mortgage is smaller. But we have to make a decision and commit fairly quickly. So we need these funds in hand by May 1st. So what we're asking is everybody to think about what you can do. If you make a donation, you can put it in the collection plate, just mark it as bond repayment. If you send it to the office, if you hand it to Judy one day, just let her know it's for bond repayment. If you have the bonds and you choose to redonate those to the church, let the finance committee know and let us know it's for bond repayment. It doesn't matter how we get there. We just need to get there, and we need to do it by May 1st. We have basically 60 days to make it happen. This is a huge opportunity. We really need to take advantage of it. I don't know who this person is. Even finance was not announced. I don't know who this person is. But I went home and I was so excited I couldn't sleep. This is amazing. Our God is great. Thank you.
We serve a good God, amen?
Amen.
buy one, get one free. I wish he was a rose. He'd teach my dad when I was selling Girl Scout cookies. Amen. God is good. God is good. We ask that you all be extremely prayerful in the way that you can help us with this situation. God is amazing. And to the person who is blessing us, we are truly grateful for what God has laid on your heart. And now, my friends, it is the time for us to give back a portion of what it is that God has given to us so generously. Now is the time for our tithes and our offerings. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for the abundance that you provide us with. We give back not because you need it, but because you call us to be responsible with all that you give us. May the hungry be fed. May those in need be blessed. Touch this offering, press it down, shake it together so that it runs over. It's in your Son Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Sow and the weeds that you can give up. So many opportunities every single day in the experiences of life that we have, whether it be in our house, with our children, with our spouse, with our friends, with each other, at church, in a shelter somewhere where we can volunteer. The thing is, God wants us. The world needs us. So whether we're in the belly of the fish, and it's bad, we're out on the sand giving praise, we always have the opportunity. We always have the opportunity to hear the compelling case of God, to live and work, striving to do good. Brothers and sisters, let us in every experience pursue that goodness with each other, with God, and the world. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you, that we may this and every day know the peace and goodness of God. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.